Hey guys, how's it going? Today I'm going to be talking about board games and phone apps and how they form into one. To be better? Well, that's debatable. Let's go ahead and discuss. Hey, now real quick before the video starts, I actually mentioned this towards the end, but I wanted to tell you right now, even if you don't watch this whole video, go ahead towards about the end. I'll talk a little bit about a video that's upcoming on Friday that I'll definitely need your guys' support on. I'm going to be sticking my neck out a lot. I'll have a big target on my back. But I think it needs to be said. It needs to be said openly. And so seriously, either stay to the end or fast forward to there if you're done with the video, so that you guys can at least see what's coming up and know what's going on. All right, let's get to it. All right, now as you saw, and in case it wasn't obvious, this is of course all my opinion, but I'm going to be talking about my thought process behind it, why I think the way that I do around phone board app games stuff, and whether or not I can make any sense of it all anyway. So first of all, I think it's important to discuss the different kinds of phone apps. I'm not even going to talk about required versus unrequired right now. I'm just talking about the different kinds. So you have some, like, for instance, the one here on Osworn that is narrative. For Osworn, it is essentially just there to read the story to you with, like, a voiceover from a voice actor and James Cosmo, actually. And I've dealt with the app before, and I've done it without the app, and him reading it, just his accent and how he reads it, and knowing that he's saying all the words correctly, or at least more correctly than I can, and not having a sore throat afterwards, has always been really nice. Additionally, it helps kind of organize play a little bit, because one of the great things about any kind of UI or UX, more specifically, that's for user experience, is the pipeline or workflow. Sorry, my software engineering might be coming through a little bit. You can control what the user does. So board games have a lot of steps, like, okay, first you gotta pick a location, then you gotta put a marker on the location, then you gotta move your person this way, then you have to take 2 health away, and then you have to, you know, do the danger track up by 3, and then you gotta pick 3 of these cards. And anytime you can control that through like an app, that's actually kind of helpful. So when you're going around an Oathsworn has a city map, and you're kind of going from location to location, and it'll open up new locations, stuff like that, the app will pop up and say, hey, you need to set this up and this up and this up, and then you can go ahead and do that. Now, you can do that without it, obviously, especially if you just know, or you can read it in like a storybook or something like that. That app is not doing anything that the regular rulebook and storybook do. It's not adding anything except a voiceover and, I guess, streamlined instructions, which can be nice, but can definitely be done without as well. So that's kind of one style. And several games, especially that I covered, that Tainted Grail, they're doing one with an app. They're just now starting to release it. It doesn't have the voiceover yet, but my understanding is it's supposed to. But it does this whole thing, and I'll even play this one for you, where it'll just play in the background. You know, you can select it, and you can, it tells you what it is. And one of the nice things about that is, for Tainted Grail, unlike Osworn, where what you're reading is just in the storybook, and you're just in there, kind of flipping between it, there's like the other side of the card that you're on that makes up the world that you can read, and then there's also the storybook as well, and then there's like verses back there. So you're kind of flipping a little bit more in that sense on that one, especially when you have stuff on there. You don't want to flip it over. You can find it in the book, but then you have to look up another thing. And so this just kind of streamlines it. Now, That's cool, and I like that. The other kind, I don't really have many examples for this, mainly because most of them are, let's just say, third-party, unofficial apps, and so I didn't want to, like, put one on display. Not that I'm endorsing anything one way or the other, just that a lot of them are, like, save states. And so with the save state, let me go ahead and pause this a little bit. With a save state, or any kind of, like, setup or anything like that, it just allows you to, organize what you've been doing in the game. For a lot of campaign games, that's really beneficial, just so you can keep track of it. Normally you get like a campaign sheet, and this is an app version of that sheet. And, in fact, I think, Aeon Trespass Odyssey has said that they're gonna have a, a save phone app, essentially, where you can kind of save where you're at and do that. And typically that's a lot easier to do than something like a narration one, just because you don't have to hire a voice actor. It's a lot less money. It's just the development cost of setting up kind of a saved form, essentially. And so that can be really useful for a lot of games as well, especially because then you don't have to write it all down. Sometimes you get in a state where you have to, like, there's not enough room. There's, like, room for one, and you save it multiple times, so you have to, like, erase it or write it on the side and stuff like that. I think we've all been there on any of our campaign games, or even, I've even done it with, like, Hate, it's kind of like a campaign skirmish game, and you're tracking, like, who's died and who has what, and we end up just doing notes on the campaign board and stuff like that. Especially the campaign board for Hate, actually. That's a great example. I'm glad I thought of it. So on the map, you can write down who owns what, but that changes all the time. So you cross out the name and then write it again. You have this, like, list of names. It's kind of funny to see a history of who's owned that territory, I suppose, but an app can really help with that. So there's narration, there's save state. I kind of view them as different because one's very story-driven and doesn't necessarily have a save state, and the save state definitely is just the save state portion. You can have both as well. That'd just be a kind of a more hefty app. If it were. Another thing I will say before I go into anything more here is that, well, actually, hold me to that. I'll say it in a bit. Okay, so the other kind we have is stuff like this. Here's the Lord of the Rings Journey in Middle-earth. These are the required phone apps. These are gameplay, but instead of in the board, it's on your phone. That's what this stuff is. So Lord of the Rings Journey in the Middle-earth, Mansions of Madness, same thing here. And in fact, they'll kind of go all in. So you see, like, here's a picture of a little sliding puzzle game that you might have to have to, like, pick a lock or something like that. So you have to, you know, obviously this one here, you're gonna have to move up, and then that one you're gonna have to move left, and then that one you can move up, and then this you can move that one down and then put that there. Bam! Just solved it. Look at that, guys. Oh man, I feel good. There you go. Spoiler alert. There's how to do that. You're welcome. Figured it out. I'm just a genius. What can I say? Okay. I was just goofing off, but anyway, so that's how you'd solve that one. Hopefully it'd get more difficult than that. Man, I might give that to, like, my 7-year-old and have them figure it out and make it difficult. Anyway, whatever. My point is that it's a lot more in depth. You're telling the game kind of where you're moving, what you're doing. You're kind of, it's definitely a companion app where you're using it for every single move. So typically what happens here is you make a move on the board. And so, like, for instance, I did this with the Descent second edition. They had one that was more close to, I think, Mansions of Madness. And essentially what you do is you do the board, and then you go and you tell the app, okay, I moved over here. And then you're like, okay, I want to loot that. And so you tell the app that you want to loot it, and it says, hey, grab those cards. So you have to grab those cards from there. So you're either going from the board and doing the action on the board and then telling the app what you did, or you're telling the app what you want to do, and then you're having to go to the board and actually do it. So it kind of doubles everything you're doing. And that's, I think, my first issue with it is I find it very cumbersome. I've never had a game feel streamlined with an app. It's always a little clunkier, especially because you get stuff like this. So every time I scroll down here, hey, guess what? There's no undo button. No undo button. So hopefully press the right one. And you know what? It's not like they learn, because guess what? That needs an undo button. Stuff like this. This person here is talking about a save issue. Especially as a developer, I can personally say that apps, anytime you have a pipeline, anytime you have any kind of worth in an app, and it's not just bare bones, you're going to have issues. You're going to have stutters and whatnot, and different weird alignment issues, and a workflow that doesn't quite work well. I've never been able to not undo a board game, right? Because it's a board game. I just undo the move, there you go. Or, oh, I didn't mean to draw that, put it back in, shuffle it up. When you control that in an app, suddenly you don't have that versatility. It's whatever the app allows you to do. And if it doesn't have an undo button, well, then I hope you like the item you drew, because you're stuck with it. You didn't want to play with that expansion? Well, you clicked that expansion was going to be included. You can't take it out. You'd have to restart the whole campaign. A lot of times you'll have to say, I want this, I have this, this, and this. And so you'll just have to restart if you accidentally did that. There's all of these kind of things that it introduces that is just inherently more constrictive. So while that's a plus because you can control the workflow, you control the workflow in a very, very rigid way, to where, unlike a board game that you can house rule, you can do whatever the heck you want with it. You can say, you know what, I want this many people in it, and I don't want this because I hate these items, and you know that I think that character's broken, so I don't even want them included in here. That enemy I will never fight because it's broke. You cannot do that in these. It inherently constricts or restricts your gameplay to an extremely, extremely large degree. There is no way to customize your game in any way, shape, or form. There's no way to interact with your gameplay in any other way except the exact way that the app is built for. Which, like I said, it's just not... unlike a video game, which even a video game we talk about a lot, you know, kind of how on rails it is, or how linear it is. And this is... these apps are as linear and as on rails and as by the books and as one-dimensional as you get. And board games inherently aren't. I've played plenty where I wanted to, you know, make it a little bit harder, so I took out some stuff. In fact, Conan was just talking about like substitutions and how there's a hard... for the hard mode of this, you can actually change these enemies with these enemies and take these items and start with these different. And that level of customization I have not seen in any phone app. And even if so, it's a lot more to develop, and it just adds more issues where that undo button kind of thing props up, where the more complex it gets, the more bugs you're going to get, the harder it is to maintain, and the harder it is to make it work on a variety of things. This is what I was going to talk about before. These apps, as far as I recall, most of these apps are actual apps. So you have apps, and then you have web apps, and the web apps are essentially a mobile site, an app form. And anytime I see something like this, I would much, much prefer a web app, a mobile app, where it's actually a website. Because then you aren't at least restricted to your phone. You could at least pull it up on like a computer or something like that, and then maybe Chromecast it up to a TV or whatever. Just to where it's just more available. It's more readily open. You can do it on Mac because you just open up Safari. There, you're done. You're good to go. Or Chrome on Mac, it doesn't matter. You don't have to worry about that iPhone versus, you know, all that, because you're just pointing to a website anyway. So whether you're doing that in Objective-C on an iPhone or Java on an Android, it doesn't really matter. It makes the development a lot less, because web apps and web developers are dime a dozen. And I think it's just more unique. But I think most of these, even if they aren't available online. I could be wrong, though. Feel free to correct me on that. It's not a big point, so I'm fine falling on my sword for that one. Okay, so here, I want to talk about this for just a minute here. In case you hadn't noticed, I am fairly anti-phone app. I like narrative apps. I like save apps. As long as both are optional, I like that. But when it comes to actually putting gameplay on an app, when you're fiddling around with this little dinky maze thing here, this is an issue I have. So this was a playthrough I watched of Return to Dark Tower. And I went ahead and I had a ball watching this deteriorate before my eyes as far as I was concerned. So first of all, it took a while to get started because the app was still in development. It was having some bugs and some issues. And, I will say that who hasn't like gone to a presentation or gone to a demo or something like that and technical difficulties delayed it? It happens. It's just a matter of life. And I'm not going to get into like having a phone charged or needing a TV in your game room or anything like that. Okay. So right now, this guy right here on the right is filming his interaction. He's like fighting somebody or something like that. And this is like the main guy that was like telling him how to do whatever. So he's doing that. And this guy, he's got a pretty good upside down view of it, right? But look at this guy here. He has nothing to look at. He's like, you may as well, you're off doing the... So I play board games to spend time with friends and family. I spend board games to be around people. I love video games, and I will lock myself in this office right here and play all the video games all day long. I get it. I love video games. When I'm around a table with, you know, some pizza over on the island and a board game on the table and my friends and family around me, I want to spend time with them. And looking at nothing, because you have nothing to look at, like this guy to the left, because somebody's dinking around on their little phone, you know, like if I'm doing this, I'm playing a board game right now, but you have nothing. You have no idea what's going on here. You have no idea what's on my screen. I don't have a TV set up. I play my dining room table. I'm not going to put a TV in my dining room. And in fact, even if it wasn't, I still wouldn't. Either way, it's just he has nothing really to look at or to be around. And this continued to happen. So here's, look, this guy, he's fighting. This guy has a pretty good view, right? Because he happens to be sitting right there. These other two dudes, though, got nothing. They, again, the people on the left, they have nothing to do. There's this, when I see a picture like this, and I have one even worse than this, when I see a picture like this, it almost breaks my heart. It's like, this is not what I want from board games. It's not why I spend thousands of dollars a year on this stupid hobby, and have my friend drive over from his home and, you know, have everybody come over and get the time off from work to be in school to be able to sit down for 3 hours on a board game and, you know, just have a great time so that I can stare at somebody's back of the phone. It's not why I play board games at all. Like, literally, that's the last thing. Honestly, my friends wouldn't come over. If all they did for half the game was stare at the back of my phone while I did something, why would they drive all the way over here? They live in another town. Like, why would they do that? So finally, I have, towards the end of the game, it's been going on a while now, and finally, Mr. Bottom Left guy, he gets to look at the phone. Congratulations. So he's able to finally do a battle. So he's saying, oh, I'm going to do this many forces, and I'm going to, I forget exactly what the mechanics here were, but, look at how everybody else is not even involved in the board game. At this point, there's a side conversation going on between these three people or four people over here. So they're just having a side conversation. He's daydreaming about playing a board game where he actually gets to do something and see what other people do. It devolved because suddenly it's my turn. I do this. I pass it to you. You do that. I pass it to you. After watching this, I would never, ever even come over to play this game with you. I wouldn't. I have no desire to ever play this game or any game like it. I cannot stand fiddling with a tiny little screen when I should be playing a board game with everybody. And it always ends up like this. So, personally for me, again, all this is personal, I don't even allow phones at the table when we play. And a lot of that's because I'm very big on just streamlined gameplay and good game flow. And what ends up happening when you're doing that is people get on their phone, they start checking Facebook or they start doing that. And then either they're like, you're like, hey, I'm attacking you, you need to roll defense, and they have no idea what's going on. Or it gets to their turn and they weren't thinking about their turn or anything else. Or like, okay, so what happened? I don't even allow cell phones at that. We're there to play a game, and that's what we do. And so the moment you get an app or a phone, and suddenly it's like, oh, hey, Bobby texted you. Do you want to? I'm in the middle of a fight, but he's asking if you like cheese. Like, we don't need notifications popping up or anything like that. It just, I would love to know what you think. And don't hate on me if I disagree with you. I mean, I guess you can do whatever the heck you want. It's the internet. You're probably going to hate me anyway. But I can't stand seeing this. Now, what really bothers me is every time I see an app, every time I see a phone app, I think, what are they doing that isn't possible in a board game? Now, I'm not a game designer. It's not my job. If I was to ask Eric Lang, hey, what are they doing that you couldn't do? He would be able to better answer if that's true or not. Just because I can't even think of a way doesn't mean that there's not an actually good intuitive way to shuffle decks or do stuff like that, or tokens or whatever random stuff that you're doing there. And a lot of times I see, like, I think it was it Sea of Thieves? It was something. No, that's a video game. There was some pirate game just recently that, had a phone app requirement, and I didn't see it doing anything that any other narrative game has already done, except they printed a storybook. Essentially, they just didn't want to print a storybook. I don't understand that. My daughter is 10, and she now has a Wi-Fi cell phone. And, it's my old phone. And I don't change phone. Like, I finally have a work phone, but before that, I didn't change phones very often. So I'd have a phone for 5 years. And so this is a phone that's quite old. I think it's an LG G5, I think is what she has. She's pretty excited about it, but, It couldn't run Discord. Like I tried to put no. She had that was the new one that's got her. So she had one that was even older than that than my wife's like old one. Either way, it couldn't put Discord on. I was too old of an Android version on that phone, and so she couldn't do it. Just recently, my wife and I went up to a cabin without the kids. It was fantastic. And we brought several board games with us. My patrons made fun of me for it, but we had a lot of fun with it. It's a cabin up in the woods, so we were able to go up there and play board games, but we couldn't have brought Dark Tower and unless it needed Wi-Fi or a good charging, and you know, our phones were mostly didn't have cell phone service anyway, so if they were on there constantly trying to get it, we could have put an airplane mode and maybe made it work as long as we didn't need an update or it didn't need online things. But my point is the moment you take the physical and make it electronic, you run into problems like that. Like, can you take it to the cabin in the middle of the woods? Could you, you know, play it on an older phone, or especially if you need one charged? Are people able to see the stupid screen? So there was, back in the day, this was when Rock Band was a thing, the video game, if you remember Rock Band. I think it was Rock Band 2. And GameSpot, there, it's a gaming website, had on April 1st, they would April Fool's their whole homepage and make like joke articles. And one of them I remember distinctly was, this was for the PSP, but they said, Rock Band on the PSP, and it showed everybody with their instruments crowded around this little screen, like trying to look into it with the guitar, like trying to see the notes on the tiny little PSP screen. And it was hilarious, because it was a joke. And then I see this joke played out in real life. And people think it's not a joke. I don't get it. I really don't. I wish I did, but I don't. It's almost like it'd be as if you had the storybook and instead of reading it out loud, you just read it to yourself and then passed it on to the next person. If they wanted to know the story, they had to read it or they just had to crowd around you because you were going to close it afterwards. So everybody had to shift their chairs to look around you and hope everybody reads it at the same time, because what you see is what you get there. And it just, I don't know. It's just not. It's not for me. I don't like it. It just fundamentally goes against. I am around again. I program for a living. I'm around computers, day in and day out for hours and hours and hours. I'm big on having family dinners where we all check out of our electronic lives and actually sit down as a family and have dinners. That we can at least do that for half an hour each day. And I'm big on my board games not having electronics either. I don't want them. I'm not into it. Now, narrative, yes, I much preferred it, like using Osworn's. James Cosmos sounded amazing. He had a fantastic voice to read it, much better than my own. My voice doesn't get sore like it is right now just talking to you guys for 23 minutes. Imagine 3 hours of narrative gameplay. That'd be a disaster. It just, I don't know. Anyway. I've been meaning to make this video for a while because it always irks me. Every time I see a required phone app, I die a little inside. If I want to play a video game, I'll go play a video game. I don't need to invite my friends over so that they can watch me play a video game poorly. like it's just not, I'm not into it at all. If you want to make the app, for people that make the app, that's fine, but then make the physical portion as well. And if you claim you can't, then figure it out, Mr. Game Designer, or make a video game. Now, before I end, do you need to make every game for me? No. So if Return to Dark Tower, if there's people who want that gaming experience, like I'm showing right now on my screen, if that's your jam and you just like the side conversations and the I'll have my turn and fiddle with it when I get it, that's fine. I'm making fun. But seriously, I think holistically, the industry needs options. Not every game needs options. So I'm not here trying to say that every game should never have it and should never be required. I want a game designer to make what they want. But if the game designer wants to make that, I'm out. 100% instantly. No ifs, ands, or buts. No questions. No answers even provided. I can send a link to this video if they have a question, I suppose. But I want nothing to do with it. I never will. That's not why I'm playing board games. It's not why I'm inviting my friends over. And it does not provide the experiences that I want out of them. So anyway, that's my two cents. Let me know yours. Seriously, I'd love to know if I'm normally I think we're pretty lined up eye to eye, at least for the most part, on concepts like this, like on what we like out of a board game or not. So I'd love to know what you guys have to say about this. Maybe you guys have some good examples of alternatives or comebacks or anything like that. I'd love to hear about it. Thanks so much, guys. And before you go, I do want to mention something. My next video, make sure my time, okay, my next video is going to be a doozy, and I'll need you guys more than ever. Seriously, I'm going to be talking about some stuff behind the scenes in the industry when it comes to professionalism, especially among critics, and just kind of how, I guess, I don't want to say whistleblow, but I don't think you guys understand how fake a lot of the channels are, a lot of online personalities are, and what these companies tend to do with influencers. And considering how transparent I tend to be and how honest I am with you guys, and it's, I hate getting these emails anyway. It bothers me, and my patrons have to endure my rants, and it's about time I rant to you guys too. So I'm going to be kind of talking a little bit more openly. I'm not going to say a whole lot of names when it comes to the influencer side of things. I have no problem saying about the customers. You guys can infer what you will on it, but obviously I'm sticking my neck out, and I'm putting a target to have responses sent to me and all this kind of crap. And I just want to let you know that I appreciate you guys regardless of anything. And so look forward to that this Friday. I'll have that video out for you guys, and hopefully it's well received and you guys like it and appreciate. Hopefully it's a little eye-opening and you guys can realize what's going on with these companies tend to do and what they're typically after and how the critics assist them in that. So anyway, that's it for that. I didn't mean to end on a negative note there. Just be on the lookout for that, and yeah, let me know what you think. I'm not a phone guy when it comes to board games. Maybe you are, and if so, I would love to hear what great experiences you've had with it. All right, guys, take care. Have a great day. Talk to you soon.